Delhi is one of the most ancient cities of the world. Empires were built on it and destroyed and then rebuilt by others. All these dramatic events have left their mark on the fabric of the city. The Rajputs, Turks, Afghans, Mughals, and the British all fought for the possession of Delhi. They built their forts and palaces and often settled down permanently. Before long, however, they were replaced by others. Delhi assimilated them all and remained impassive to the vicissitudes of fortune, survived invasions, plunder, and massacres, and yet, like the mythical phoenix, rose again in new splendor. Its history is no less the story of India's than it is the history of the whole of Asia. For centuries, its splendor turned the heads of the Western world. If Rome was the center of ancient Europe, Delhi was the metropolis of Asia. The city has been the coveted capital of many empires. Battles over its possession have left it a mere skeleton of its former splendor, but enough remains to bear testimony to its rich and glorious past. If there is any place in India which presents a panorama of 3,000 years of continuous habitation and centuries of architectural activity, it is Delhi. Between 1857 and 1911, the British functioned from Calcutta as their capital, but in 1911, that changed. Delhi once again regained its former status and became the capital of British India, and a new city was built outside the walled city of the Mughals, New Delhi. It was believed that he who held Delhi held and ruled India, its strategic position making it the most logical choice. Thus it came about that as well as being the administrative capital during the British Empire, it also became the center of one of the great innovations of the Victorian era, the age of the steam railway. Railways were introduced into the country in 1853, the same year as the telegraph system. The British laid 62,000 kilometers of track throughout India, with the first line opening on the Great Indian Peninsula Railway between Bombay City and Tana in April 1853. Though the Raj is no more, the romance of the golden age of rail travel still lives on in India. The Indian Railways, in conjunction with the Tourism Corporation of Gujarat, produced a train to resurrect a glamorous past age, the Royal Orient. We met the train at Delhi's cantonment station, which was to be the starting point for a seven-night adventure through Rajasthan and Gujarat, two of India's most culturally fascinating states, states of palaces, fairy tale cities, and bewitching beauty. As the passengers are greeted in the train's own waiting lounge, they are given a traditional Indian welcome, a garland of fresh flowers, and the customary red mark on the forehead. The ceremony over, and the passengers are escorted to the train and to their respective carriages. 30 or so strangers from countries as far afield as Canada, the United States, Korea, Great Britain, Germany, and some from India itself, all about to share a unique and once-in-a-lifetime experience. A luxurious and opulent adventure in a style that was previously enjoyed by India's elite Maharajas. an opportunity to experience one of the world's oldest civilizations and some of the most glorious dynasties, and to explore the land and its rich history. For the next 7 days, they were going to live in regal splendor aboard India's traveling palace, the Royal Orient. With preparations complete, the magnificently restored steam engine pulls gently out of Delhi. The journey has begun, and over the next week, we would cover around 4,000 miles, traveling mainly overnight. The Royal Orient train is a special tourist train, which is made up of 14 passenger coaches, 2 restaurants, 1 bar and lounge, and 4 service coaches. The original coaches were meant to be the personal coaches of erstwhile rulers of the princely states of Rajputana and Gujarat. 2 of the coaches were also drawn from the special rolling stock of the Viceroy of India and the Nizam of Hyderabad. After independence, separate railway organizations of the princely states were merged into the Indian Railways. But these special coaches could not be used as normal passenger trains on account of the very rich and stylish interiors. As a result, all these coaches were parked in different yards and sidings as part of a heritage which was far too ornate, old and historic, to be of any practical use. They remained in this state for almost a quarter of a century. Now, with its restoration, the pieces of this heritage have been put together, providing a unique travel alternative to tourists, and the old world charm was brought up to standard for all the rail enthusiasts of the world. The steam engine will only haul the train for the first 2 hours of the journey, where we will change over to a diesel engine at Rewari. The interiors of the train have retained the richness and opulence of their former days. Elaborate paintings of women in traditional Rajasthan dress adorn the walls of the corridors. The spacious cabins with their rich colors and hand-embroidered bed covers are clean, comfortable, and tastefully furnished. They are fitted with all the modern amenities you'd experience in a first-class hotel. Ornate fittings, painted ceilings, and an air-conditioned ambience that keeps the temperature down to 15 degrees. Attached to each cabin is a spacious private bathroom with a fitted shower. At the end of each carriage, which contains 4 cabins, there is an exclusive lounge area with seating for up to 8 people. Passengers can escape from their cabins to the comfort of sofas to watch television, read, or to enjoy the passing scenery. We are nearing our first stop at Rewari Junction, where we will be departing from our steam engine. The train pulls into Rewari Station, where the large diesel is coupled to the train. The steam engine has been disconnected and moves to another track. we leave Rewari behind as we continue on our journey towards Chittagong. The train attracts much attention from the locals, and the young children run to keep up with us. We are travelling through the fascinating state of Rajasthan, which sits in the north of India and borders with Pakistan. This is the home of the ancient Rajput princes and warriors and age-old palaces, citadels and fortified cities. It is early evening, and most passengers have settled into their cabins for the night. The train has its own library. At the other end of the library is the bar, known as the Watering Hole, which is well stocked with a wide variety of drinks. It remains open until the early hours and is very comfortably furnished. We stop briefly to allow another train to pass. Our journey overnight will take us south from Delhi to Chittagong, continuing on to Udaipur. Day two, and we have arrived in Chittagong. Chittagong is steeped in tales of victory and valour in Rajasthan's sometimes violent history. We are to be taken by coach to Chittagong Fort. Chittagong, once the pride of the Rajputs, has Rajasthan's noblest yet tragic history. Chittagong Fort was built in the 7th century and sprawls over 9 acres. The fort is remembered for the 3 bloody sieges which dominate the annals of Rajput history. The first sack of Chittagong occurred when the Sultan of Delhi was determined to bring Princess Padmini, wife of the Maharana, back to his harem. Legend has it that the fort was held under siege for 6 months. The princess offered a consolation of showing her face to the aggressor, but only in the reflection of a mirror. Struck by the mesmerizing beauty, the Sultan attacked the fort. But the noble princess preferred death to dishonor, and the womenfolk of the fort chose to commit Johar to die by committing mass suicide in a sacred fire rather than face dishonor. Over 130 years later, history repeated itself when over 13,000 women and children died in the same way in a last desperate act of defiance. Some 30 years later, several thousand women and children, including 5 princesses and 5 Ranis, were consumed in the sacred flames after an attack by Emperor Akbar, which killed 2 young chieftains defending the fort. The fort resembled the city of the dead, and the destruction of the buildings was ordered. In 1615, the fort was restored to the Rajputs. Today, the 9-storied watchtower, the 12th century Tower of Fame and sculptures of the Jain Pantheon, and the Rana Kumbha Palace all make up the beautiful and historic complex. At the end of an enjoyable morning, the coach was waiting to return us to Chittagong Station. We returned to our cabins to enjoy breakfast, while the train continued on towards Udaipur. Leaving the romance of Rajput history, we wove our way through the desert state of Rajasthan. More than half of Rajasthan is desert or semi-arid, a continuation of the sand belt that girdles the world. This desert belt is separated from the Indian peninsula by the Aravalli Ranges, geologically the oldest mountains in India. Both the Thar Desert and the Aravalli Ranges lend their distinct personalities to the landscape of Rajasthan. It is interesting that this picture of a rocky, rugged skyline over the soft, stared dunes where camels plod is only one of the 2 clichés which depict Rajasthan. The other, diametrically opposed, is a refreshing contrast, and one we were to experience this afternoon. Placid blue lakes with island palaces, gardens with pavilions and kiosks. We slid gently into Udaipur station. Known as the City of Dawn, Udaipur is built around clear blue lakes and overlooked by the lush hills of the Ara valleys. Udaipur is a fascinating blend of sights, sounds and experiences, and an inspiration for the imagination of poets, painters and writers. The city has a profusion of palaces, lakes, temples and cenotaphs. Possibly the city's most spectacular sight, and perhaps one of India's most famous picture book scenes, is the elegant Jagnivas, built in 1746 on Lake Pikola as the then ruler's summer residence. The Jagnivas, which can only be approached by boat, is now, under the new government legislation, the Lake Palace Hotel. The Royal Orient passengers are greeted and treated to a sumptuous lunch in the lush setting of this splendid edifice. Possibly one of the finest settings for any hotel in the world. For the same prices as any other fine hotel in India, guests can stay in what was once the Maharaja's private suite. Marble statues fill the beautifully landscaped gardens. From the terrace are views of the grand city palace of Udaipur. We leave the grandeur of the hotel, sitting majestically in the lake. The city palace is a labyrinth of courtyards, pavilions and terraces, surrounded by crenulated walls. A network of narrow corridors with right-angle bends mean that any insurgent enemy would be forced to advance in single file through the tortuous palace complex. This was a palace built for a Maharana, one step up the regal ladder from a Maharaja. The Suraj Gokada, or the Balcony of the Sun, is where the Suryavanshi Maharanas of Mewar presented themselves to the people in times of trouble to restore their confidence. A brief visit to Udaipur Gardens completed our day before returning to Udaipur Station. We reboard what has now become our travelling home. Most of the passengers retire to their cabins, although the lounge and bar car remain open. The Narmanda lounge is elegant. Glass tabletops rest on wooden carved elephants, deep red sofas and ornate fittings complete this beautiful room. In the warm glow of the evening sunset, the train snakes its way through the plains. Gliding gently and sedately along the rails, it's almost as though you are coasting on a conveyor belt. The low rays of the early evening sun shimmer on the side of the polished carriages. There is nothing quite like watching the skies change colour as you roll through the ever-changing landscape. With the sun extinguished, it's time to join the rest of the passengers who have retired to the cabins for the evening. From Udaipur, the train will travel further south through the night, arriving in Mehsana early in the morning. The dawn breaks through on day three of our journey. We are due to arrive in Mehsana at 6:45 a.m. By dawn, most of the staff are up and working. Breakfast was served in our exclusive lounge area. We've almost arrived at Mehsana station. We would be leaving the train early today for a full day of excursions. The excursions on the Royal Orient are not optional, so the days can be quite long as the excursions generally begin at 6 to avoid the midday heat. Today, we would be visiting a stepwell, a weaving centre and the Modira Sun Temple before travelling on to Ahmedabad, where we would visit Gandhi Ashram before returning to the train. the coach was again waiting to transfer us to Rani Ki Vav in Patan, where we would visit one of the largest and most sumptuous stepwells of its kind. The greatest reminder of the golden period of Gujarat under the Solanki kings is the Queen's Stepwell, the oldest and grandest of all the 120 stepwells built in Gujarat in 1050 AD. Each step is a procession of marvelous sculptures, layer after layer, created by the master craftsmen of the bygone era. Our next stop is the Patola Weaving Centre, home of the famous Patola silk saris. In a privately owned house, we are given a demonstration on the lengthy process of producing a sari by hand, in the original and traditional way. The Sun Temple at Madura is a rare edifice of the Solanki era. Built in 1026 during the reign of King Bhima of the Solanki dynasty, the temple is dedicated to the sun god Surya and stands on a plinth overlooking a deep stone step tank. The temple is an imposing structure and is counted among the best specimens of Indian art and architecture. Every inch of the edifice is elaborately carved with figures of gods, flowers, and animals. We return to the train, which is sitting majestically at the platform. We were to continue down to Ahmedabad. As we left Mesana behind, the passengers made their way down to the dining cars for lunch. There are two restaurants on the Royal Orient, the Sasangir and the Velvadar. Each restaurant can seat up to 30 people, so there is seating capacity for 60 passengers to dine. The interior decoration has been designed keeping in mind royalty and Gujarat. The colors are rich and the decoration ornate, with inlaid ceilings, rich mahogany woods, mirror glass sculptured artwork, and stained glass adorning the walls. We continue through the historic and vibrant state of Gujarat. The Gandhi Memorial Museum in Ahmedabad is a set of austere yet beautiful buildings nestling amidst mango trees. It was from here that Gandhi experimented in non-violent methods of political struggle. From the beginning, Gandhi waged a moral protest against oppression by defying unjust laws and willingly taking punishment. Gandhi, however, always imposed one inviolable condition. Defiance of law, or civil disobedience as it came to be called, must always be completely peaceful. He would often undertake fasts lasting several weeks until his demands had been conceded. The museum, added later, is stunningly simple and a fitting tribute to the great man. Designed by Charles Courier, a well-known Indian architect, it displays many photos, paintings and artifacts depicting the life of Gandhi, who had become the father of the nation. Back at the train station, the Royal Orient was waiting to transport us to our next destination. Our visit to Ahmedabad had been brief, but it was a city steeped in history. The city was founded in 1411. After the city's rise to glory with the accession of Mahmud Bigdo, Ahmedabad grew in wealth and splendor and became the center of skilled craftsmen and merchants. But with the decay of the Gujarat dynasty, the prosperity of the city declined and it was conquered in 1572. Back on board the train, the team of skilled chefs were preparing dinner in the stainless steel environment of the train's galley. The food is freshly prepared, and the cuisine is as fine as any five-star hotel. Equal to the standard of food on this train is the standard of service, which can only be described as formal but not stuffy, yet it's also informal but not intrusive. The ambience of the dining car is one of refined elegance. Travelling overnight, the train continues on from Ahmedabad through Sasangir to Delwada. As dawn breaks on day 4 of our journey, the first thing we notice is the change in the landscape. From the dry plains, the vegetation is now much greener, and there are fertile lands of wheat, cotton and banana plantations kept green by the rivers on the coastal plains. As the train draws into the station, the passengers are preparing for the first excursion of the day to Somnath Temple on Gujarat's coast. Somnath Temple is considered to be one of the 12 most sacred Shaivam temples in the country. The plundering armies of Muslim zealots destroyed it several times, but it was to be rebuilt again and again. The temple, standing on the original site on the tip of the Saurashtra Peninsula on the Arabian coast, has been constructed in the style of Chalukyan architecture. Views from the terraces overlook the Arabian Sea and the long stretch of beach which is used by locals rather than tourists. The sand and lapping waves are a welcome relief from the constant bustle, jostling and chaos of the city life. People, camels, horses, and other animals can all be found on the quiet shores of the waterfront of this local beach. Sasangir Forest is not only one of the most important wildlife sanctuaries in India, but also the only place in the world outside Africa where the majestic lion can be seen in natural habitat. Antelope roam within close vicinity of these beautiful cats. Not expecting to see the lions, we were amazed that these spectacular wild animals lay magnificently in front of us, not remotely interested. From the confines of the sanctuary, we return to the train which is standing at Sasangir station. Each saloon has two liveried attendants who are well informed, smiling and courteous, and they are on hand 24 hours a day, meeting their guests as soon as they disembark from the train or coach. As soon as the train is given the green flag to depart, the passengers move to the Velvadar dining car. This carriage was originally built in 1937 at Jodhpur workshop for the use of the Maharaja of Jodhpur. Next destination is Delwada and an excursion to Diu. Diu is a former Portuguese enclave. Now a union territory, it is steeped in history. Situated in Diu, St. Paul's Church, dedicated to Lady of Immaculate Conception, was started in 1601 and completed 9 years later. The main facade of the church, perhaps the most elaborate of all Portuguese churches in India, is adorned with curiously treated volute and shell-like motifs. Inside, the ceilings are inlaid and walls are painted in subtle blue and white. F- Fort Dieu is situated on the coast of the island and was constructed between 1535 and 1541. Dieu was a seaport and naval base of considerable strategic importance from the 14th to the 15th centuries. It was also a vital trade link with the rest of India for traders overseas. The Fort of Dieu is an imposing statement of power. It was built over 6 years from 1535 AD, following a defense alliance between the Sultan of Gujarat and the Portuguese when the former was attacked by the Mughal Emperor. The fort is skirted by the sea on three sides. Several cannons still stare menacingly from the top, and some are peeping out of the holes on the walls of this giant structure. The fortress of Panikota is a magnificent stone structure located right in the middle of the sea. Built at the mouth of the creek, the fortress makes beautiful viewing from and around Dieu City. On the other side of Dieu is the beautiful Mandvi Beach. With the afternoon to ourselves, we have time to unwind with the luxurious amenities of the resort at our disposal. We would remain here for the rest of the day. Set amongst the natural surroundings of palm enclaves, Mandvi is bountifully blessed with nature's endless wonders. Long stretches of golden sand, warm waters and golden sunsets make a perfect day before returning to the train. We will travel north overnight, departing Delwada for Palitana, where we would be visiting the temple city, then traveling north again towards Ahmedabad. As dawn breaks, we are into day 5 of our adventure, and we are to visit the most important center of Jain pilgrimage at Palitana, where we were to make the journey of the pilgrims. Travelling by elegant horse-drawn carriages, we made our way to the base of the Shatrunjaya Hill for what was for us the most memorable day of the trip so far. By foot, it'll take 2 hours to complete the 4 kilometers or the 3,572 steps. Chair slings carried by 4 men transport anyone who is unable to make the walk. Palitana is an essential pilgrimage for one of India's most austere religions, Jainism. Every day, thousands of pilgrims embark on the long ascent to the top, where the entire summit is crowned with over 1,000 temples. These temples were built over a period of 900 years. After the morning's experience, it was easy to understand why India has always intrigued the traveller. In 1897, Mark Twain described India as the land of dreams and romance, of fabulous wealth and fabulous poverty, of splendour and rags, of palaces and hovels, of famine and pestilence, of genii and giants and Aladdin lamps, of tigers and elephants, the cobra and the jungle, the country of 100 nations and 100 tongues, of 1,000 religions and 2 million gods. Today's visitors, from the moment they step off the plane, are assaulted by contradictions no less vivid and paradoxes no less puzzling than they ever were. While it is this variety and complexity that makes India attractive for the traveller, it is also the source of India's many difficulties, past and contemporary. We are now over halfway through this wonderful journey with fairy tale cities and grand palaces, and one thought about how it would be possible to see India any other way. We had seen so much in such a short space of time, with still a great deal more to see and do. It would not be possible by air, and if you travel by road, it would take a great deal longer without all the comforts of a traveling 5-star hotel. This has to be the best way for a first-time visitor to see this country. After an afternoon recovering and resting, we arrived into Sarkej and were taken to Ahmedabad, where we were to dine in traditional style at a 5-star hotel. A magnificent Indian meal was served on the terrace under a moonlit sky, capturing the romance of India at night. Returning to the train, we departed for the penultimate day of our journey. Again, we travel overnight, traveling north from Sarkej back to Udaipur, where we would visit Ranakpur Jain Temple. It is day 6 of our adventure, and we are back in the wonderland of Rajasthan. We have arrived back at Udaipur platform, where we are to travel by coach 95 kilometers from Udaipur to Ranakpur. Ranakpur Jain Temple is one of the 5 main holy places of the Jains, situated in the heart of a remote and enchanting valley. Placed on a lofty plinth, the 3-storied marble edifice to which the genius of the artist has imparted exquisite artistic grace. There are a number of beautiful and delicately carved sculptures in the shrine which defy comparison. These 500-year-old temples are well preserved. There are 29 halls, 80 domes, 1,444 pillars, all with intricate carvings. The graceful marble pillars and the domes of different heights with flat ceilings combine to produce an excellent effect. The temple is an eloquent testimony to India's cultural heritage and her unique architecture. Every year, thousands of art lovers and spiritual seekers from all over the world come to this idyllic place. The afternoon is spent exploring the grounds of a reconstructed Indian village, where there are traditional houses, craftsmen, and entertainment in its various forms. We are able to experience Indian culture close up without the constant harassment of local children or traders talking endlessly to encourage us to buy, which I think we had all found exhausting by this point. The houses are museums, and we are free to wander at our own leisure, taking in the sights and artifacts on display, gaining a greater understanding of village life. We marvel at the skill of the artists, their inborn sense of colors and forms, and are tempted to acquire the fabric, silks, paintings on paper, ivory or cloth, and the vast array of pottery. In the quiet confines of this sedate village, we watched as local handicrafts are made and sold in vibrant colors. There is entertainment around the village throughout the day. Returning to Udaipur station, the train was waiting proudly at the platform, sparkling resplendently in the early evening light. The Indian Railways not only run the Royal Orient train, but they also run the famous Palace on Wheels, which just covers the area of Rajasthan. The railways employ a massive 1.5 million people, the world's largest employer. It moves 10 million passengers a day and is remarkably efficient. Travelling by the Royal Orient gives the most intensive introduction to the areas of Rajasthan and Gujarat in relaxed comfort, without the delays and charmlessness of airports. There is no better way to get the pulse of the subcontinent than to view the changing scenery from a carriage window. A window on our train comprises several layers to keep out the sun, dust and ticketless traveller. It was almost time for us to move on, and the passengers have settled back into their cabins. We would continue north, leaving Udaipur and travelling overnight to Jaipur, where we were due to arrive early morning. We glided into Jaipur station for our last full day of excursions. Having enjoyed breakfast, the passengers disembark to begin a tour of the city. Jaipur, known for obvious reasons as the Pink City, is the capital of Rajasthan and is a charming mixture of the old and the new. It was painted pink for a state visit of the Prince of Wales in 1883. Pink being the traditional Indian colour for welcome, and the buildings of Jaipur have remained this colour ever since. A strange blend of exotic medieval architecture sits amongst the modern setting. The street life is chaotic, yet somehow organised. Women folk decked in silver jewellery and bright coloured swirling skirts proudly promenade amid snake charmers and street merchants. It should be said that for a first-time visitor to this country, some of the sights of Indian street life can be initially distressing. Beggars can be a nuisance, but armed with a few 10-rupee notes sporadically distributed to ease one's own conscience, it is something you soon become accustomed to, even if you don't fully comprehend it. This is Jaipur's world-famous landmark, the Palace of the Winds, a remarkable five-story structure which forms part of the city palace. It was designed for the royal ladies as a place where they could watch the processions on the street, looking out from behind the small lattice windows without fear of being seen by the common man. Just outside of the city, we stopped to take in the magnificent view of the water palace of Jal Mahal. This building, as palatial as it first appears, is in fact only a facade which was built for the Singh dynasty in the early 17th century as a hide for duck shooting. Further up the hill, we reach Amber Fort, a grand and imposing medieval structure which preceded the city of Jaipur. This was once the capital of the Mina tribes, believed to be the original inhabitants of this area. It was here that we learned the significance of the elephant that greeted us on the station platform. These gaily painted caparisoned elephants were the means on which we would climb the steep winding road leading up to the fort. As the great lumbering beasts slowly edge their way up the narrow track, one couldn't help thinking that riding an elephant in this way can only be likened to riding a roller coaster backwards. There was one consolation, however, the promise from the guide that we would be taken back down the hill in four-wheel drive vehicles. Our perilous journey, however, was well worth suffering, for once we got inside the fort gates, we truly realized that we had been transported back in time. Amber Fort is a spectacular mix of massive gateways, courtyards, stairways, and pillared pavilions and palaces. It was Man Singh I who fortified the original structure left over from the Mughals. This grand courtyard, Jaleb Chowk, is where the vast armies would line up and parade before marching out to war. The double-story pavilions, rows of rooms and high walls surrounding it, lend grandeur to the whole setting. From the walls of the fort, one gets a magnificent view over the whole of the city of Jaipur. Amber Fort is overlooked by the Calico Hills, where a few deserted grand mansions of chiefs, councillors, and dignitaries stand clinging to their slopes. A narrow path descends into the valley, where ruins of the ancient amber can still be seen in derelict temples and decaying houses and sunken courtyards. Crumbling stone walls lie beside the small antennae-topped houses which have mushroomed all around. The journey back down the hill was, as promised, by four-wheel drive. However, by comparison, most of the passengers would rather have chanced their luck on the elephants. Our next stop was Jantar Mantar. To a visitor uninitiated in the sciences of astronomy and astrology, the various stone and marble instruments built near the city palace might appear interesting but confusing.
So now main function is this, that we can get the position of the sun. Sun is on which part of zodiac sign? So today sun is on Scorpio. You can see the ring shadow on the marble slab there, and the dragon in Hindi there, the Scorpio. Now six zodiac sign, you can see in southern hemisphere, six northern.
Looking like a set for a science fiction movie, these instruments are the most precise modes of studying the movements of the sun and calculations of time. These futuristic instruments, measuring all aspects of the sun's movements, were built between 1728 and 1734 by Sawai Jai Singh II, who was a great scholar of astronomy. The Samrat Yantra is the most accurate instrument at the observatory and is in fact at 90 feet high, the largest sundial in the world. Today, these ancient yet precise instruments are used by the people of Jaipur who come here to predict important dates, such as the perfect wedding day. The final stop in Jaipur was to see the city palace, which overlooks the observatory. The city palace, or Chandra Mahal, forms the core of Jaipur. The private residential quarters are concealed behind high walls and imposing gateways. Passing through the rhinoceros gate, you enter a courtyard surrounded by double-story rows of rooms with balconies. In the center stands Mubarak Mahal, an exquisite guest house designed like a jewelry box. This now houses the Palace Textile Museum. Sarhad Ki Diori is the magnificent gateway to the palace itself, with its splendid polished bronze door and its central arch flanked by the palace guards and two elephant statues in white marble. Beyond this gate is yet another courtyard, at the center of which stands the Diwan Ikas, a double row of marble pillars supporting engrailed arches. The palace itself stands majestically on the northern side. The city palace, although now open in parts to the public, retains apartments which are still in use today by the present ex-Maharaja, Lieutenant Colonel Bhawani Singh. As the evening closes in on Jaipur, the passengers are dressing for dinner to enjoy their last evening on the train. We leave Jaipur to make the last and final leg of our journey, which is now almost at an end. We reflect on the past 7 days, during which time we have experienced the warm hospitality of the Royal Orient crew and the verdant heartlands of Western India, with its rich treasure of history. From Jaipur, we travel back to the starting point of our journey, Delhi. Our final morning on the Royal Orient, and we arrive back in Delhi early morning. We are sad that the journey is over, and that we will have to say goodbye not only to the train, but to our fellow passengers, with whom we formed a bond over the past week. As everyone says their goodbyes, we say farewell to the wonderlands of Rajasthan and Gujarat, the land of deserts, maharajas, lakes and palaces, and to the palace that has become our travelling home for 7 days and 7 nights, the Royal Orient.